Hi, welcome to HR Insights with SN. While you were speaking, you mentioned something on an employee dropping his resignation letter. But at the same time, the HR manager still went ahead to terminate. Right? So, obviously, from your perspective, you think that is wrong. Why do you think that is wrong? And what is your advice?
When it comes to wrongful termination, there are several shreds, several types of wrongful termination. The example I gave is just one type of wrongful termination. And you can imagine, it's quite malicious for an HR practitioner or someone that calls himself or herself an HR practitioner to proceed to terminating an employment where the employer has already resigned. And I'll tell you the implication. Now, the implication is that resignation effectively brings a contract of employment to an end on the part of the employee. Now, termination on the part of the employer also brings a contract of employment to an end. So if the employee resigns and you've accepted it, what is the purpose of your subsequent termination, particularly like 2 or 3 days to the effectiveness of the resignation?
I think most HR managers, they derive joy in terminating employees.
Exactly. So that is the paternalistic approach I was talking about the other time. You know, seeing yourself as an overlord, trying to lord yourself over employees, and it is totally unaccepted. You know, is uncalled for. So in that situation, the implication is that something is already dead. Now, the resignation kills the contract of employment. The termination further kills it. So the courts, for any reason, would never countenance that termination. And it is also synonymous to unfair labor practice. You know, for you to go ahead and terminate, you know, an employment whereby the employer has already resigned. So that's the implication of that. Now, we have several other types of wrongful termination. And one other type that is also very important to mention is a situation whereby the employer will terminate, ensure that the termination has immediate effect as contained in the contract of termination, and now fails to issue out 1 month's salary in lieu of notice that is stipulated in the contract of employment. That is also very wrong. Now, one reason that they usually give is that, especially if the termination occurs during the month or before the end of the month, they will say it is not yet payday. That end of the month is payday. And as a result, they cannot pay 1 month's salary in lieu of notice until end of the month. But again, they need to realize the fact that immediately they give out that letter of termination that takes immediate effect, the employment of that person immediately ceases. And consequently, any other thing that is attached to that employment should be paid to that person immediately. It is very important. Now, the reason I'm even saying this is because there are several cases where this has been held. You know, in the case of Felix Iwari Oshonebo against West African Examination Council, the Supreme Court said therein that resignation does not take effect on the date that is contained, nor on the date of the acknowledgement, but on the date it is received by the person that has that right to receive it. So immediately the employee resigns and the employer receives it, it takes effect immediately. Now, conversely, immediately the employer also gives the employee letter of termination, it takes effect immediately. And all the concomitant rights and privileges that is attached to this contract of employment should be given without any further ado, else it will be seen as wrongful termination. And the third type of wrongful termination is an instance whereby employers go ahead and terminate without any reason. That has also been deprecated by the National Industrial Court, and this is the most common thing. And HR practitioners normally use this because they rest on the platform of an employer's right to terminate with a good reason, with a bad reason, or for no reason at all. But again, this is becoming less fashionable now. Now, in the case of Ibrahim Unyikachi against Diamond Bank PLC, the National Industrial Court held there that by the principle of the Termination Convention, Article 4 of the Termination Convention 1982, that it is no longer fashionable for employers to terminate without not giving any reason. In fact, if we take a look at that article says that if someone wants to terminate, you need to give a reason. If employer wants to terminate, they need to give a reason. And that reason must be based on either conduct, performance, or operational requirement. So again, we need to understand that it is no longer the case that termination will come now without any reason. So those are the types of wrongful termination the employers need to, and several other types, because we also have instances where employers will also terminate as a result of sexual harassment. You know, that can also be seen as wrongful termination.
So who is harassing who? Employee harassing employer? No, employer
harassing employee. And when you see that situation, you notice that, you know, it is quite very, very unfair on the part of an employee, and I've handled several cases like that. Although these cases are sensitive, and I may even not be able to, they are sensitive, and some of these cases are pending in court.
To cut you, because I just want to understand this particular scenario you just painted.
Yeah.
So is it that the employee is alleging that the employer is harassing her or him?
Yes.
Right? And that leads to the employer terminating the employee.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. As a result of failure to concede to the sexual overtures the employer. Mm. And the implication of that is that employer will terminate, you know, basically leveraging on the fact that I can terminate without not giving any reason at all.
Yes,
and that is why reference should now be made to Article 4 of that Termination Convention 1982 says that reasons should be given. It's because of this act of employers of this nature that particular article says that reasons should be given.
Okay, so I have reservations with all of these 1982, I wasn't even born then. So imagine there are very sensitive principles in those articles, but they are not captured in the labor law. Don't you think somehow maybe the government or whatever body that is responsible for this should actually look at reviewing all of this so that the labor acts will be all encompassing, so that people will not feel, okay, obviously there is a saying, ignorance of the law is not an excuse, yes?
Yes.
However, it would be also ideal if we have all of this captured, or most of them captured, in the Labor Act.
Now, in response to your question, let me say that, well, I agree to an extent, because if we look at the 1974 Labor Act, and that is the extant Labor Act that we're still using now, I will agree to the extent that it is anachronistic, it is old, and should have been reviewed. But again, we need to understand the fact that there has been an amendment to the Constitution. That was in 2010. We call it the Third Alteration Act. Now, the implication of that amendment is that it gave the National Industrial Court the exclusive jurisdiction to handle labor matters. So that means by that amendment, the National Industrial Court is recognized as a superior court of record.
Yes, please.
Now, that is not the only thing that amendment did. Section 254C, subsection 1F and H, and subsection 2 of that particular amendment actually now gave the National Industrial Courts the power to apply international best practice and the power to apply convention that have been ratified. Now, it needs to be noted that that is quite a very novel and innovative provision. Mm-hmm. And the reason it is novel is this. Pursuant to Section 12 of the 1999 Constitution, mm-hmm. no courts can apply no treaty or international instrument or international law, except those treaties have been domesticated and have been turned into law. Mm. But Section 254C of the Third Alteration Act actually overpowers that. So that means that National Industrial Court is the only court given that exclusive power to apply ratified convention, but has not been domesticated as long as they are with respect to labor matters.
Yes, please.
That means that all the conventions, ILO convention, for example, the Termination Convention 1982 Article 4 that I mentioned can be applied as international best practice.
Yes,
notwithstanding the fact that that particular convention has not been ratified, notwithstanding the fact that that particular convention has not been domesticated, it can nevertheless be applied.
Okay.
So that is why we see that all this convention have been applied now. For example, we have Convention 111 that talks about discrimination. We have Convention 29 that talks about forced labor.
Can they just summarize it and put it in the Labor Act? That's my question.
Because yes.
you are the lawyer. I can see how much you eat and enjoy it. But we in the HR space, we don't. Like, we just want to go straight to the point and get this sorted out and move on.
Now, we need to understand something. It is not all this. There are some conventions that have been adopted and domesticated.
Okay.
For example, Convention 29 that talked about the forced labor convention says that anybody cannot be subjected to forced labor.
Okay.
Now, that particular convention has been domesticated in Chapter 4, Section 34 of the 1999 Convention as amended that talked about dignity of woman person.
Okay.
But there are some new conventions that have not been domesticated. And for this convention that have not been domesticated, these are conventions in which National Industrial Court can apply as international best practice.
Okay.
And part of this convention is this Termination Convention 1982. So the fact is this, for every international instrument that we have, if these international instruments are usable, the National Industrial Court can apply them as international best practice.
Okay.
And that obviates the need for all this convention to be contained in the Labor Act. Because I tell you, there are conventions that are coming up daily. For example, we have the Sexual Harassment Convention of 2019.
Okay.
Are you saying that the convention will be amended or the Labor Act will be amended as far as this convention has been created? No. And that is why there is an omnibus provision in the Constitution that permits the National Industrial Court, being the court with the exclusive jurisdiction to handle labor matters, to apply this convention, either ratified or if they are not ratified, as international best practice.
From our headline sponsors, partners, and producer, we say a very big thank you for staying tuned.